Father God, we praise you. We thank you for your goodness and kindness. You've been so wonderfully kind to us. And for all of that, we just say thank you. Lord, may we never tire of giving you the praise, the glory, and the honor. They all belong to you. Now we need a word from you. God, speak to our hearts, speak through us, that your word may go forth, that our coming will not be in vain. And we'll be careful to give our name the praise. The victory is already yours. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank God. Let every heart say, thank you, Jesus. We give praises to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and to Pastor Anderson and to Pastor Conley. Appreciate Pastor Conley for doing some double hitting on last weekend in our absence, and to all of these officers and these mothers, to each of you. It is good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Our God has been so kind to us and has just looked beyond our faults and have allowed the golden moments of our lives to roll on again. This is Youth and Young Adult Month, and I'm glad to still be able to get some preaching in on a youth month. Amen. It makes me still feel young. And so today they're talking about loving yourself. And today I want to call your attention to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. I want to read for you here in verses 1 through 20. Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 1 through 20. And again, appreciate Salisbury's and King family being here. Amen. And appreciate the Span family worshiping with us as well. Spans, where are y'all? Spans, amen. Amen. Bless y'all heart. Amen. Boaz and Barb are my favorite folks here at Brown. Amen. And we appreciate you all worshiping with us. Mark chapter 5, we read this a couple of weeks ago in responsive reading. And if you're following along, and I hope all of us are doing this, please make sure you pick up our reading devotional in the month of July, August, and September. We're going to be in Mark and Genesis and Job. Well, today we're going to be preaching from what is the devotional plan for tomorrow. So go ahead and pick this up. Tomorrow you'll have a head start on this reading. And all month of July, our young adults are writing the devotionals. And so I appreciate them. And it's always just refreshing to get some young, youthful perspective on these passages of Scripture. Mark chapter 5, verse 1 through 20 from the New Living Translation. So they arrived at the other side of the lake in the region of Gerasenes. When Jesus climbed out of the boat, a man possessed by an evil spirit came out from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the burial caves and could no longer be restrained, even with a chain. Whenever he was put into chains and shackles, as he often was, he snapped the chains from his wrist and smashed the shackles. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Day and night, he wandered among the burial caves and in the hills, howling and cutting himself with sharp stones. When Jesus was still some distance away, the man saw him, ran to meet him, and bowed low before him. With a shriek, he screamed, "Why are you interfering with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In the name of God, I beg you, don't torture me." Jesus had already said to the spirit, "Come out of the man, you evil spirit." Jesus demanded, "What is your name?" And he replied, "My name is Legion, because there are many of us inside this man." Then the evil spirit begged him again and again not to send them to some distant place. There happened to be a large herd of pigs feeding on the hillside nearby. "Send us into those pigs," the spirits begged. "Let us enter them." So Jesus gave them permission. The evil spirit came out of the man and entered the pigs, and the entire herd of about 2,000 pigs plunged down the steep hillside into the lake and drowned in the water. I hope those ribs y'all were eating on the 4th.
The herdsmen fled to the nearby town and the surrounding countryside, spreading the news as they ran. People rushed out to see what had happened. A crowd soon gathered around Jesus, and they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons. He was sitting there fully clothed and perfectly sane, and they were all afraid. Then those who had seen what happened told the others about the demon-possessed man and the pigs. And the crowd began pleading with Jesus to go away and leave them alone. As Jesus was getting into the boat, bless you, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. But Jesus said, "No, go home to your family and tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been." So the man started off to visit the 10 towns of that region and began to proclaim the great things Jesus had done for him. And everyone was amazed at what he told them. Amen. I want to preach about this morning from this subject, love your selfie. Love your selfie. Selfies. Facebook post, Photoshop shop, and Snapchat. Social media has made it easy for us to paint a picture of our wonderful life. We capture the moments. We post the prettiest pictures. We share our most blessed accomplishments of what is going on in our lives. I read this on Facebook just the other day. Just paid off $38,679 in debt. Got a $377,850 from a settlement. Credit score just hit 736. Got approved for a brand new 2020 AMG S63 and booked a 2-week yacht cruise on the Mediterranean Sea. This ain't me, y'all. All of my finances are flourishing and going on another month-long trip in July to South Africa and Brazil. I don't know whose status this is, but it said copy and paste. And I think that's what a lot of folks are doing on social media. They're just copying and paste. Because the sad truth of the matter is, brothers, a lot of time it's just a cover-up. Hiding the hurt. Glossing over the guilt. Trying to pretty up the painful situation that they find themselves in. Because the truth of the matter is, a lot of folks really don't love themselves. They've been beat down for so long, talked about and bullied and pressured until they really, when they look in the mirror, they don't see anything beautiful about themselves. And yet the Bible teaches us that there is a healthy love for self. Matter of fact, the Bible said that we ought to love our neighbors as ourselves. And so without a healthy love of yourself, it's going to be impossible for you to even love each other. And so the question becomes then, where is the balance, preacher? How can I love myself without becoming selfish? How in the world can I think positive about myself without becoming prideful? How can I be happy and humble without becoming haughty and hateful? What do I need to do to truly love myself? Boy, I'm glad y'all asked. Y'all asked such good questions, amen, on the first Sunday in July, because I believe we can learn a lot from this man in our text in Mark chapter 5. Here's what I'm going to hang my hat on, y'all, that since you ought to be glad and grateful about your testimony, keep the spotlight on Jesus. Since we ought to be glad and grateful, don't let anybody beat you down for the blessing that God is giving to you. Don't feel ashamed at your blessings. Don't feel as if you have to hide the good thing. And then don't ever think less of yourself. Don't you know that you're created in the image and after the likeness of God? He knew everything about you. He stitched you together. Every bit of you is beautiful in the eyes of God. But here's what we got to do, y'all. We got to keep the spotlight not on ourselves, but on the Lord. And I believe this man can show us how to do it this morning. What transparency this brother's life had. I mean, everybody knew this brother's business. We don't even know his name, y'all, but I can only imagine in my mind he was blamed for everything. Because everybody knew that's Crazy Joe up there. He's in, when the chickens were stolen, Crazy Joe did that. I know Crazy Joe did that. Everybody knew that this was the fella living in the cemetery. His life was transparent to everybody. But then what a transformation this brother experienced in the presence of Jesus Christ. Because you talk about somebody that was out there, y'all. He was as out there as you can get. He was out of control. The Bible says nobody could tame him. Not even chains could hold him. He was out of character. He was even out of his clothes. Luke chapter 8 verse 27 said that he was running around naked. Now as hot as it has been, brothers and sisters, I tell you, that's crazy. He was even out of circulation and out of commission. He was away from the city, away from his family, up in the tomb. But oh, when he met Jesus, a change took place. The Lord transformed his life. And I'm too glad that Jesus is still in the transformation business. He can still take those who are even out there and bring about a change in you. But then what truth he gives to each one of us, what a lesson of truth he gives to us. That if you're going to love your selfie, here's what he says to all of us this morning. Let me give it to you and I'll let you go. First of all, don't hang out with wrong people. Don't hang out with the wrong people. I call this check out your homie. Check out your homie. Because Mark chapter 5 verse 2 and 3. Look what the Bible says. When Jesus climbed out of the boat, a man possessed by an evil spirit came out from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the burial caves. Do y'all see where this brother is? He's in a cemetery. He's hanging out with dead people. Now, when I was growing up, one place you didn't just hang out at was a cemetery. I mean, I don't care how big and bad you thought you was, everybody was scared of the cemetery. I mean, I declare I saw Hanks hanging around that cemetery. And yet this man is living among the dead folks in the cemetery. Many of us, our address is not in the cemetery, but our acquaintances are dead. Many of us are running with dead folks. We're hanging out with dead folks. How can I tell that the folks that I'm with are dead? Let me give it to you. They are always disobedient. Always breaking the rules, crossing the line, pushing the envelope, wanting to buck the system, do what your mama and daddy told you not to do. They are disobedient, but they are the enticers. They are the ones always encouraging you to do wrong. Y'all remember though, folks, go on, smoke it, go on, smoke it. Ain't nothing gonna happen. Go on, smoke it. Try it one time. Enticer. That's why Proverbs chapter 1 is going to say, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 10, my son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Say no to those that keep trying to get you to do wrong. They're disobedient. They are enticers, but then they're angry. Dead folks are angry. They get mad real quick. They pop off about anything, and I tell you, they're always blowing their top. Then after snapping you up, I didn't mean it. You better run from them. They're always angry. But then that last D in dead, they're always discouraging. You ever run across some folks like that? They don't ever want you to be happy about anything about you. It's got to always be about them. So they're always singing the blues, always trying to keep you down, always discouraging you in your dreams and in your thoughts and what you want to accomplish in, like, yeah, I wouldn't do that. No, I wouldn't. They tell you it don't look good on you, and then they go by. Dead folks. dead folks, brothers and sisters. And if you're going to love yourself, it starts with meeting Jesus and changing the company that you're hanging around. That's what happened there. Verse 6, look what the Bible said, that when Jesus was still some distance away, oh, good God Almighty, despite everything that was going on in this man and all of the demons that he had inside of him, when he saw Jesus, he ran to meet him, bowed low before him. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you, it starts with meeting Jesus for yourself. You see, if we're going to go to heaven, y'all, we can't go on mama's faith. We can't get there on big daddy's religion. You need to know him for yourself. And here's what I love. When you get to know Jesus, good God Almighty, he'll make a change even in your company. Young folks, Proverbs 13, verse 20 is right. He that walketh with wise men shall be wise, but a companion of fool shall be destroyed. And so if you love yourself, don't hang out with the wrong people. Too many folks in jail right now because they were just hanging out with the wrong people. That so many folks that are strung out on drugs right now, addicted because they were simply hanging out with the wrong people. So many have gotten caught up and their future has been altered. Their future has been limited. Why? Because they've been hanging out with the wrong. Mama was right. One bad apple will spoil the whole bunch. And so if you love yourself, don't hang out with the wrong people. What do we need to do then, preacher? What do we need to do? Spend time at the feet of Jesus. You truly love yourself, you spend time at the feet of Jesus. Luke chapter 8. Verse 35 in Luke's account of this story. Look what Luke said. People rushed out to see what had happened, and the crowd soon gathered around Jesus. And when they saw the man who had been freed from the demons, he was sitting at the feet of Jesus, fully clothed and perfectly sane. And they were all afraid. Brothers and sisters, spend time at the feet of Jesus. The best thing that you can do for your young, for yourselves, young folk, is to spend time with Jesus, reading his word, meditating on him, allowing him to live inside of you and through you. Spend time at the feet of Jesus. Don't hang out with the wrong people. But if you love yourself, not only don't hang out with the wrong people, if you love yourself, don't harm yourself with the wrong practices. Don't harm yourself with the wrong practices. I call this, we need to check out our habits, check out our habit, because this brother was doing some stuff that just wasn't healthy. Look what verse 5 says, day and night he wandered among the burial caves and in the hills, howling and cutting himself with sharp stones. You know, there's a new lie the devil is putting out. And it's really not a new lie. It's just an old lie that he done dressed up. And he's got folks believing that there's no right and wrong. That there's no good and bad. He tells folks moderation is the key. I mean, everybody need a little something. This is the lie that the devil is saying, that a little bit ain't gonna hurt nobody. And so go on, smoke, go on, smoke. Just don't smoke the really bad stuff. Go on, flirt, but just don't get caught. Matter of fact, devil tell folks, go on, like everybody done lied before. But just don't tell the really big lies. Because there's really no good and bad, no right and wrong. Can I tell you something, Brown? Can I tell you something? That's a lie from the devil that you ought not believe. Oh, brothers and sisters, there are good habits and there are bad habits. And this man had some bad habits. And let me tell you something, young folks, wrong practices, bad habits will eventually catch up with any and everybody. Don't ever think that you're going to be the exception to the case. No, if you do wrong, if you start having wrong habits and wrong practices, eventually it'll catch up. What were some of the habits that he had? What were some of the habits that he had? No rest. No rest. No rest. Verse 5 said, day and night, he's wandering among the burial cave. No rest. No rest. Something as simple as going to bed. You think you're young. You think you got all of the energy. And so you stay up all night long partying, drinking, doing any and everything, thinking you can stay up even in the daytime and keep going. Can I tell you, it'll catch up with you. You wonder why you're 25 looking like 75. I'm here to tell you, the Bible said everybody needs some rest. Yeah, there was no rest, but then he had no responsibility. This brother ain't punching a clock. He ain't at somebody's job. He's not working. No, he's up there in the cemetery. No rest, no responsibility, and then no respect for others. He wouldn't even let other folks get a good night's sleep. The Bible said every night he up there howling, oh! No respect for others. He didn't even have respect for himself because he's hurting himself. He's harming himself. The Bible says cutting himself with sharp stone. Brothers and sisters, can I tell you something? Bad habits will catch up with you. Let me give you a couple of bad habits, young folks. And I know this might not be politically correct, brother, y'all, but let me tell you something. If you got a practice of doing drugs, I don't care how many folks legalize it, what they say about it, brothers and sisters, that's a bad habit that will eventually catch up with you. It ain't hurting me. You already can't even get it out straight. It's a bad habit. The drugs is a bad habit. Let me give you another bad habit, young folk. Running with these gangs, getting caught up with these gangs. It's a bad habit. You want some family to come to church? You need something to do, y'all. Let me tell you something. The gang is a dead end street. You're not going to be the exception. You might think that, hey, here it is. If this one died, that one got killed, that one got shot up, how in the world do you think you're going to be able to go into it and be the exception to the case? It's a bad habit. Don't go down that road. Let me give you another bad habit, young folks, young adults. Let me give you another bad habit, having all these different partners. This week, somebody. That next week, somebody. This month, that in the club this night, meeting this one in the club. Can I tell you something? That's a bad habit. And what the Lord is saying, stop harming yourself with the wrong practice. Stop shooting yourself in the foot. Stop doing these bad things to yourself. But instead, you ought to place your faith in Jesus. Place your faith in Jesus. Because how many know that when you put your trust in Jesus, he'll change not only your heart on the inside, but he'll change even your habits on the outside. 2 Corinthians 5:17 is right. If any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, all things have become brand new. Thank God for this brother. Because when he met Jesus, good God Almighty, the Bible says there, verse 15, look what the Bible says there, that he was sitting there fully clothed and perfectly sane, and they were all afraid. Let me just throw this in for the tidbit. Let me just throw this in. How many old schoolers? I know this is a young crowd. How many old schoolers in here? How many old schoolers in here? This is what everybody, we used to hear this all the time in our prayers. Here's what the old deacon would pray. Lord, I thank you because when I woke up this morning, I was clothed and in my right mind. I used to wonder where in the world, why were they saying that clothing in my right mind? Now you know where they got it from, that this man was clothed in his right mind. Can I tell you something? Don't you take for granted when you wake up in the morning. First of all, when you open your eyes, you ought not take that for granted. But if you can have some clothes on, you know the life that you used to live, you don't you take it for granted. And if you're in your right mind, mind, and the devil has not snatched your senses away. Thank God for the change. Thank God for the change. Stop harming yourself with the wrong practice. Place your faith in Jesus Christ. Let me give the last one, and I'll let you go. Brothers and sisters, don't haggle about his wise purpose. Don't haggle about his wise purpose. Check out where it's really happening. Check out where it's really happening. Everybody wants to be where the action is happening. And this man was no exception. He wanted to be in on the action. He wanted to be with Jesus. Look what the Bible said. Verse 18, the Bible said that as Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. But Jesus said, no. Go home to your family. Tell them everything that the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been. I thought about that. I thought about it, that here it is. He was willing to travel. He was willing to drop everything. He was willing to give his all to do anything. He was willing to go the last mile. Matter of fact, he ran down to the boat and was begging Jesus, let me go with you. But Jesus told him, no. Got to be honest with you, Brown. When I read that, I even had a question for Jesus. Why, Jesus? Couldn't you let this brother go with you? In my mind, I could see it in my mind, Jesus, when you get through preaching and talking about the kingdom of God is at hand and the power that you have, you could look over to him. He could be an example. He could be the exhibit A. He could be the testimony of your transforming power. Why wouldn't you let him go with you? Oh, but look what Jesus said. Jesus said, preacher, you don't understand. You need to go back and read verse 17. The crowd began pleading with Jesus to go away and leave them alone. Ain't that something, y'all? But here it is, Jesus had done something nobody else had been able to do. They couldn't even tame the man with chains. And yet Jesus spoke a word, and the demons left the man. And yet instead of embracing Jesus, they were begging Jesus to leave them alone. We don't want your kind here. I thought that even interesting that here it is, y'all will pull up with a crazy man, howling and raising sand all night long, but you don't want the Prince of Peace in your midst. Something is wrong, brothers and sisters, when we can put up with the sinners and the devils, but we don't want Jesus in our midst. Jesus, what he told me was this right here. They shut the door on me. And I knew I couldn't go back to where he was coming from. And so what I did was I wanted to send him back. Because in sending him back, I was really taking myself to those places that they had shut me out of. And so every time this man spoke up, guess what? Jesus was in the midst. Because when he went back home, he began to tell everybody what Jesus did. They didn't want Jesus in the bars and in the clubs. But when the fella showed up Friday night and started talking about what Jesus did in his life, Jesus was right there in the club. They didn't want Jesus in the classroom. But when this brother walked through the classroom doors and began to testify that I was a wretch undone, but Jesus made a change in my life. Jesus was right there in the classroom. They didn't want Jesus at City Hall. But when the brother showed up for city council, and they said, he told them, y'all can enact all the laws that you want to enact. But let me tell you how to bring about a change. It starts with a man named Jesus, and I'm a testimony that if you're down, he can pick you up. And when they did that, Jesus was right there in City Hall. So here's what the man teaches us, y'all. If you're going to really love yourself, wholeheartedly follow Jesus. Don't argue about where Jesus want to send you. Don't argue about what Jesus want to do. But you wholeheartedly follow Jesus. Go where he tells you. Do what he has commanded you. Say what he gives you to say. Why? Because he has a plan for your life. He has a wonderful plan. He'll take you places that you never thought you would go. He went from the cemetery to being a preacher for Jesus, a missionary for the Lord, who was not just in one town, but he went to 10 towns. He went to Decapolis and began to proclaim the good news. He was sold out for Jesus Christ. Boy, that blessed my soul. Because without Facebook, without Instagram, without a Twitter account, this man went viral. He went viral everywhere. He was telling somebody, I was naked, but he dressed me up. I was out of my mind, but he brought me back into my right mind. His testimony could not be refuted. His deliverance could not be doubted. He was able to say, y'all know who I am. Y'all know my past. You know where I was. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. I have what I have. And it's because of Jesus Christ. And because of that, his transformation could be trusted. Thank you, Jesus, for using this man who loved himself enough to go and tell other folks what the Lord had done for him. He made a change, not only in the man, but even in the crowd around him. I know I gotta let you go, but look at verse 15. In verse 15, they were afraid of Jesus. But when you get down to verse 20, and they began to hear the testimony of this man, the Bible said everybody was amazed at what he told them. They went from being afraid in verse 15 to being amazed in verse 20. They went from being apprehensive in verse 15 to being accepting in verse 20. They went from doubting in verse 15 to believing in verse 20. What am I trying to say? God will use you. God will use you. God will use me. And when other folks try to cut Jesus out, he'll use our testimony in order to bring folks to Christ. Thank you. Thank you. That's why we ought to be like this man. And that whenever God does anything for you, you ought to tell it. You ought to tell it. You ought to tweet it out. Put a post out. You ought to put it on Instagram. You ought to share it and tell it with somebody else. When God deliver you, you ought to tell it. When God breaks some habits, you ought to tell it. When God deliver you from addictions, you ought to tell it. When God opens some doors, when God give you a job that you wasn't even qualified for, you ought to tell it. You ought to tell it. If he could go viral, each one of us could go viral with the testimony of the goodness of the Lord. That when I was a wretch undone, wasn't fit to live, on my way to a burning hell, but God looked beyond my faults. But God saw my every need, and it was amazing grace that found me when I was lost. And so you ought to tell it, you ought to tell it. That's the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the good news that one Friday morning on an old rugged cross, Jesus died for your sin. He died for my sin. He went down in the grave. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I don't know what your testimony is, but can I give my testimony? One Sunday night, down at New Hope, I came to Jesus. Just like I was weary, wounded, sad, but I found in him a resting place
and he has made me glad. I'm glad he took an old country boy. He put the word in my heart. He put joy down on the inside. Thank you, Jesus. I can love myself. Thank you, Jesus. I know I got a past, but he loved me in spite of my past. I know I done made some mistakes, but he loved me. And so you can love yourself this morning. But when you love yourself, make sure you keep the spotlight. Make sure you keep the spotlight. You ought to let somebody know that the spotlight, it ain't on me, but it's on Jesus. It's on Jesus. Every time they compliment you and talk about how good you look, don't you take the spotlight for yourself, but you put the spotlight back on Jesus and tell somebody, it's Jesus that got me looking good. It's Jesus that's got me living good. It's Jesus that's got me feeling good. You take the spotlight and you put it on Jesus. Don't ever let them pat you on the back, but tell them all praise go to my God, for he opened the doors. It go to God. And so put the spotlight on Jesus Christ. And when you put the spotlight on Jesus, can I tell you what he will do? He'll put the spotlight on your feet, for his word will be a lamp to your feet and a light to your pathway. He'll show you the pathway to take. He'll show you where to go. He'll show you what to do. When you put the spotlight on Jesus, he'll even shine the spotlight on those around you, so that you'll be able to know who your haters are and who's really for you. Put the spotlight on Jesus. And so this morning, help me with a little testimony. If you got your phones, if you got your phone, and you know God has been good to you, if you know it was nobody but God, turn on your spotlight, turn on your light, and let's give a testimony that I am a living testimony. Put the spotlight on Jesus Christ. I'm a sinner saved by grace. I was dead, but he picked me up. I was on drugs, but he delivered me. I was in darkness, but he brought me out. Yeah, yeah. Now look around, look around, look around. I see the testimony. I see the testimony. I see the testimony. You ought to tell it, but can't nobody tell it like you. What the Lord has done for you. Yeah. Sing a little song that said, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine all in my home, all on my job, everywhere I go. Yeah! Love yourself. Love yourself. Love yourself. Don't hang with the wrong people. Stop harming yourself with the wrong practices. But you say yes to what God has for you. Go where he sends you and be a testimony. Shining the light, the spotlight on Jesus. The door is open. Invitation is extended. Somebody today, you came
And maybe this brother is a reminder of where you came from. And today God is saying, you don't have to leave here like you came. But you ought to get up and you ought to run and meet Jesus. He's standing in the door of your heart and he's knocking right now. And he's saying, come, come, come. He wants to make a change in your life. He wants to do something wonderful in each of our lives. If that's you today, if you're a sinner, you can be saved today. If you admit that you're a sinner, believe in what Christ did on the cross. He'll save you right now. He'll change your address from cemetery to Christ. And if that's you, say yes. Maybe you're already saved, but you need a place to call home. And the Lord has been speaking to your heart that this is a place for you. This is a church where you can be surrounded by family to love you. If that's you, say yes today. Say yes today. Say yes today. Yeah, say yes today. Come, come, come. Come. Maybe you're here. And I tell you, you've been struggling day and night. You're stressed, pulled in every direction. You've been searching for peace. Peace can only be found in Jesus Christ. And so today, if that's you, stop the search, stop the running, and give your heart to Christ. If that's you, come, come right now, come right now. Say, I need him. I need you, Jesus. Yeah, yeah. What did he do? What did he do? What did he do? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He can do the same thing for you today. He wants to change you today. Get up from you. If you're in the balcony, if you're in the risers, get up and say yes to Christ. Yeah, yeah. Brought somebody here. You know they need to change. This is the time to nourish them. This is the time to push them in the side. This is the time to grab their hand and say that, hey, I'll walk with you. I'll come with you. But you ought not sit there. You ought not remain in the same shape that you're in. You ought not remain with you, wherever you came here. Let the Lord change. Yeah, yeah. Come on, come on, come on. Come on. Pray, church, pray, church. Pray, church, pray, church. Yeah. Today, somebody needs to know that if the Lord did it for me, he can do the same thing for you. He can change. He can deliver you. He can set you free. Yeah. I'm so glad.
unto each one of us. I pray that we will forever keep the spotlight on you, that we would never be ashamed, never be afraid to love ourselves for all that you have done for us, that we will brag and tell others that it was nobody but Jesus. Thank you right now. Thank you for these who have come, God, knit their hearts with our hearts. Oh, don't know why they came, God, but you know, and you're able right now to heal and to deliver and to set free. Getting ready to worship you around the table, God. Sanctify us, consecrate us, forgive us of every sin, that we may eat and drink worthy of these elements. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.